Hello, this is Lazarus at telecomTech, where telecom and networking technologies are simply explained. Today, we'll be simply explaining the OSPF DR/BDR operation. Take a look at my free 27-page career roadmap for network and telecom professionals. It'll help you make decisions concerning the next steps to level up your career. It's free at my website at the link in the description below. And as always, if you like what you see, subscribe, like, and hit the bell icon. Now let's get back to the OSPF DR/BDR operation. Now when we deploy OSPF using a multi-access technology such as Ethernet, we need a mechanism to help streamline OSPF operation. If you have multiple OSPF routers on a single network segment or broadcast domain, like this one, you will have to establish many OSPF adjacencies. Specifically, each OSPF router must become adjacent with every other OSPF router in the network segment, simply because all of these routers are in the same subnet. But such a full mesh of OSPF adjacencies would look something like this. The number of OSPF adjacencies needed for a particular number of routers connected to the same network segment is governed by this formula here, where N is the number of routers in the broadcast domain. If we plug in 5 for N, which is the number of routers we have in this network here, we get a value of 10 adjacencies. So for 5 routers, we need 10 adjacencies to be formed. That may seem fine, but what happens if we go to 10 routers? Plugging in the numbers, we get 45 adjacencies. As the number of routers increases, the number of adjacencies seems to increase exponentially. Well, actually, if you want to be mathematically accurate, the number of adjacencies grows quadratically, not exponentially, which is still fast, but it's not as fast as exponential growth. But in any case, it is a drastic increase in the number of adjacencies. Anyway, math lesson over. So the more adjacencies we have, the more network traffic we have, the more CPU and memory is being used by each router, and thus the operation of OSPF quickly becomes inefficient and overwhelming. For this reason, OSPF is designed so that for multi-access network segments or broadcast domains such as this, a designated router or a DR is elected. Now, a DR is a router that will become an OSPF neighbor with every other OSPF router in the segment. This eliminates the need for a full mesh of adjacencies. In this topology here of 5 routers, we only need 4 adjacencies. All other routers will send their topology information to the DR, and the DR in turn will inform all routers in the network segment about all the information that has been shared. Now, this is actually not the whole picture, because other than the DR, there is also a backup DR or a BDR. This is defined so that in the event that the DR fails, the BDR will be able to take over almost immediately. Now, all of the other routers in the network segment also create an adjacency with the BDR router as well. Now, the rest of the routers, those that are not a DR or a BDR, are called DR other routers. Some may pronounce this as DROTHER, which rhymes with brother. In any case, the rule is that the DR other routers do not create OSPF adjacencies between them. So ultimately, for a multi-access segment of 5 routers, if we count the adjacencies with each of the DR and the BDR, we need 7 adjacencies. Now, this may sound insignificant since otherwise we would need 10 for a full mesh arrangement. But when the numbers scale, because of that quadratic growth, we can see the difference. For example, a topology with 30 OSPF routers on the same segment would need 435 OSPF adjacencies. But with a DR/BDR present, including the adjacencies with both the DR and the BDR, we need only 57. So you can see how the use of a DR and BDR increases efficiency at scale. Now, what do the DR and BDR do? Well, the DR acts as a centralized point for collecting and distributing link state advertisements or LSAs on the segment. And actually, DRs will send out a specific type of LSA, which we'll talk about in a future video. The DR maintains neighbor relationships with the DR other routers, as well as with the BDR. The result is reduced overhead in several areas. First of all, as we have said before, we have fewer adjacencies, which means reduced network CPU and memory overhead. But it also means fewer exchanges of OSPF messages and avoidance of LSA flooding on the network. This arrangement allows the OSPF databases in all the connected routers on the network segment to understand the full topology without every router needing to talk to every other router directly. The DR will also forward the LSAs to the BDR, just like it forwards its LSAs to the DR others as well. Now, the backup designated router, or BDR, is always ready to take over immediately in the event that the DR fails. Remember, the BDR also has OSPF adjacencies with all DR others, and the DR others actually send their LSAs to the 224.0.0.6 multicast address, which is the all DR routers address, which includes the DR and the BDR. So the BDR receives the same LSAs that the DR receives from the DR others. So its link state database is synchronized with that of the DR. So it has all the necessary information it needs to take over at any moment. However, the BDR does not actively participate in the LSA exchange. This means that it doesn't send any LSAs to any DR other routers, unless the DR itself fails and the BDR takes over. So it silently receives LSAs, maintains an updated LSDB, but doesn't send out any LSAs to DR others. Now, what happens if a DR fails? And how do we define a DR failure? Just like any other neighbor adjacency, if the BDR stops receiving hello messages from the DR after the dead timer expires, it considers the DR dead. So the BDR promotes itself to become a DR. Remember, the BDR already has adjacencies with all DR others, and it has an updated LSDB, so it enters the DR role immediately. So if the BDR no longer receives hello packets from the DR and the dead interval expires, the BDR becomes the DR. The hello and dead timers are 10 seconds and 40 seconds respectively. So it will take up to 40 seconds for a BDR to realize that the DR has failed before it takes over. That may seem like a long time, but keep in mind that if a DR fails, the rest of the OSPF topology is still stable and is routing traffic. So user traffic will not be affected, except of course for any traffic that is served by the DR itself. The rest of the OSPF topology remains converged and operational. Now, once the BDR has promoted itself to a DR, there is no longer any BDR. So the rest of the routers, the DR other routers, have an election among themselves to choose a new BDR. The DR stays since it already has been defined, so no election takes place for the DR. Once the new BDR has been elected, it forms adjacencies with the rest of the DR others, and the OSPF DR-BDR arrangement is stable once again. Now, what happens if the old DR comes back up? The simple answer? Absolutely nothing. If there is a functioning DR and BDR on the OSPF topology, the choice of these roles remains stable. In other words, the choice of DR and BDR is not preemptive. This is done by design to maintain stability and avoid unnecessary churn. Now, you may have noticed that I haven't really talked about the DR-BDR election process, and I've done that purposefully. I wanted to clarify the details of the DR and BDR operation before we go into a description of how the actual election process takes place. The DR-BDR elections will be discussed in the next video. For now, I hope you found this video useful, and if you have, please click that thumbs up button. Please check out my website and subscribe to my newsletter. You'll find the links in the description below. And don't forget to subscribe to the channel to get updates to newly published videos. I'm Lazarus at Telecom Tech. I hope this has been helpful for you, and I'd like to thank you for watching.